Okay, we're going to get started. Good day, everyone, and welcome to the webinar, Allocating Staff Costs Between Administrative and Activity Delivery Costs for CDBG Grantees. My name is John McGaugh, and I work at the National Center on Family Homelessness, a practice area of American Institutes for Research, and I'll be moderating today's webinar. I want to thank all of you for joining us today. Today's webinar features the following presenters, all from HUD. Steve Johnson is the director of the CDBG Entitlement Program. Gloria Coates is a CPD specialist in the CDBG Entitlement Program. And John Laswick is the acting deputy director of the Entitlement Communities Division. Also, we have with us Diane Lobasso, Puping Huang, and Karen Pierce on the line with us as our resource advisors to help answer any content questions that you may have. Next slide, please. Now, before we begin today's presentation, I want to go through just a few logistical announcements. Today's webinar will last approximately 90 minutes, and it is being recorded. The webinar recording and the PowerPoint presentation will be posted next week on the OneCPD Resource Exchange Training and Events page at the web address shown on your screen. And an email will be sent to all attendees following the presentation with instructions for how to get credit for this training and also to request that you complete the feedback survey, which is of great help to us to constantly improve these webinars. Next slide, please. Now, given the large audience we have today, all attendees will remain on mute for the duration of the webcast. Also, due to audience size, there may be a slight delay in the advancement of slides. So if that happens, please bear with us. You can submit questions at any time in the Q&A pod that will appear on the left of your screen. And your questions are very important to us. There will be a formal question and answer session at the end of this presentation. And we may not have time to answer all questions that have been submitted. However, a frequently asked questions document will be developed and made available. You can also use the Q&A pod to request assistance if you experience any technical difficulties at any point. And now, before we begin with our first presenter, we have a poll question that we'd like to put on the screen. If we could put the first poll question up. And this is to give us a baseline of some of the knowledge in the room. So this is a true or false question. So if you could answer this live, computers may be purchased as an ADC or an activity delivery cost. Is that true or false? And you can answer right on the screen. So we see how the scoring's going. I'll give you just another couple seconds. Looks like it's barely tilting to true, and the answer is true. The purchase of computers that are necessary for the activity being carried out, for example, training on Microsoft programs as part of a job training, those are eligible as an ADC of that activity. And I think Gloria later in the presentation is going to speak to that. But with that, thank you for your weighing in. I'd like to hand it over to our first presenter, Steve. And Steve, over to you.
Thank you very much, John. And thank you, everyone, for joining us today. We hope this is informative for you. The things we are going to cover in today's presentation are defining and differentiating program administrative costs as opposed to activity delivery costs. We are using these terms more officially now to help differentiate between them. We will talk about when and how you can charge program administrative costs or activity delivery costs for other programs to the CDBG program. We will talk about costs of preparing your consolidated plan and your annual performance report and environmental review costs. Gloria will also talk a little bit about what do you do when you have what we call discontinued activities or terminated activities, where you spend some preliminary activity delivery costs, but then the activity does not go forward. We will talk a little bit about how you actually comply with the 20% cap on planning and program administrative costs, which is the annual request that you have to make. We will also wrap up with talking about some special considerations for urban counties. And that's important because it's important to realize sort of where this notice even came from and why it came to be. We have to agree, this was a long overdue notice, and it also had a pretty long gestation period. It really started some years ago when we in HUD headquarters got some questions from one of our field offices. They had monitored a particular urban county, and they made some findings against that grantee concerning whether or not the county was appropriately charging certain expenses, as activity delivery costs, given that the county spent all of their money by distributing it to the units of local government that made up the county. Along the way, as we started answering that, we also got a lot of questions in both from field offices and from grantees about when you could charge, costs of administering other homeless programs and other consolidated plan programs to the CDBG program. We know of a number of cases where grantees either were already hitting the administrative cap for those other programs, or they were trying intentionally to use CDBG money to cover administrative costs to maximize dollars from those other programs going to actual service provisions. We got questions in sort of in the same time period about the ability to charge costs of the home program, both activity delivery costs and program administrative costs. So on top of those, we have to recognize some other important factors that have been going on in the last few years that affect the amount of money the grantees can spend on activity delivery costs and even more so on program administrative costs. The last few years, we've watched the appropriation levels for the CDBG program slowly decline. Appropriation levels nationally went down 26% from 2010 to 2012. In real terms, if your grant had been $600,000 and it declines to $450,000, then the amount of program administrative costs that you can charge under the 20% cap go down from $120,000 to $90,000. But, you know, reality intrudes here. It does not cost you 25% less to run a grant that is 25% smaller in dollars. Program administrative costs are simply not elastic with total grant amount. It's even worse if you have a very small grant. If your grant was, say, $240,000 and it declines to, say, $180,000, then the amount of money that you have for program administrative costs under that 20% cap declined from $48,000 to $36,000, which is probably less than the bare minimum it will take for you to run the grant. On top of that, we've got local fiscal constraints that you all have been dealing with. You certainly know this better than we do, even. With local budgets being severely constrained because of declining revenues, a lot of grantees that used to cover or subsidize the cost of administering the CDBG program simply didn't have the resources locally to do that anymore. So grantees were forced to start charging the CDBG program or some of these other federal programs costs that previously they would have been covering themselves. And we've also seen grantees get very creative in trying to make sure that they are charging everything that they can as an activity delivery cost to avoid bumping up against the 20% cap on program administrative costs. Frankly, sometimes I think grantees have tried just a little too hard in that regard. And we can't ignore the fact that certain grantees have probably faced some political pressure to, shall we say, bury general government operating costs in the CDBG program. We know we've seen that in a few cases. We've also seen outside stakeholder interest in the question of how much money is being used for administrative costs in the CDBG program. Congress has asked questions of us, asked for data. The U.S. General Accountability Office did a study of this several years ago, And we can't forget the fact that in 2012, the U.S. House budget proposal actually proposed to reduce that 20% cap on planning and administrative costs down to 10%. Fortunately, that did not pass. Many of you may also be aware of the Office of Inspector General audit that was issued about 2.5 years ago about the CDBG program. It looked at IDIS data. We discovered a lot of activities that had expenditures, and then the activity was canceled with no net result coming out of those expenditures because nothing was completed. That has informed a lot of what we've said in the last couple of years about what you do about activity delivery costs for discontinued activities. One point that probably is not of great concern to most of you, but we have had questions, and that is, well, does this notice 13-07 apply to the state CDBG program? And if not, why not? At the lowest level, talking about activity delivery costs, it's probably possible to use this as interpretive guidance. However, states have fundamentally different statutory requirements. How the program operates is fundamentally different. States do not carry out activities directly. They are required to pass the funds to local governments. There are statutory differences in how the 20% cap on planning and administrative costs is even computed. So it would just be impossible to try and build the state program in to this notice given the fundamental differences. On your screen here, you can see sort of a slideshow layout of some of the costs we're going to cover here. I am now going to turn the presentation over to Gloria Coates, who is one of the authors of this notice. John Laswick, who is also here today, was also one of the authors of this notice. Gloria will talk next about differentiating between activity delivery costs and program administrative costs, and then she will talk about when you can charge costs for other programs. And then I will be jumping back in talking about consolidated plan costs. So, Gloria?
Thank you, Steve. Good morning, everyone. Generally, we're going to start off with a definition of what are activity delivery costs, also known as ADCs, versus program administration costs, also known as PACs. Activity delivery costs are simply the allowable costs that are incurred for implementing and carrying out CDBG-assisted activities. It may cover the cost of the staff that directly carries out the activity, in addition to equipment and supplies that are necessary for successful completion of the activity.
Yeah, and I was just going to throw in here that these terms are somewhat HUD-specific, but if you think about activity delivery costs in a more generic term, I think people call these project management costs a lot of times. You know, a developer would have project management costs for the people who are actually, you know, directing the construction of a building or something like that. So this is sort of micro level, and then the program administrative costs are a little bit more macro level.
Thank you, Joe. The program administration costs are PACs. Those are costs for staff time and overhead costs for planning and general administration of the CDBG program as a whole. It covers the costs of planning activities, general management of the CDBG program, oversight, coordination, and implementation of the CDBG program. The regulations for program administration costs are found at 570-206, and it makes it a little more clear. It says the payment of reasonable administration costs and carrying charges related to the planning and execution of community development activities that are assisted in whole or in part with CDBG funds, and where applicable, housing activities. But does not include the staff and overhead costs directly related to carrying out these activities eligible under 570-201 through 204, since those costs are eligible as part of such activities, or ADCs. ADCs are the allowable costs, as stated earlier, incurred for implementing and carrying out specific eligible CDBG activities. They must be allocable to a CDBG-assisted activity or an activity that is CDBG eligible, meets a national objective, and other CDBG program requirements must be met as well, which are found in 570-200 of the regulations. They are eligible ADCs as part of the cost of carrying out CDBG-assisted activities found at 570-201 through 204 of the regulations. Some brief examples of activity delivery costs of the CDBG program that may be paid with CDBG fund, salaries of employees for the time devoted to implementing and carrying out specific eligible CDBG-assisted activities, such as public services, rehabilitation of public facilities and improvements, or housing rehabilitation. Examples are on your screen, housing rehabilitation specialists that perform inspections on housing units that have been rehabilitated with CDBG funds, persons who are providing direct job training on basic computer skills and programs, persons who are directly involved in the activities, such as those who bag up and distribute food at a food bank. Also, the cost of materials that are acquired, consumed, or expended by the staff in carrying out that eligible CDBG-assisted activity. For example, uniforms for code enforcement staff working in eligible areas. The file cabinets used for filing applications for CDBG assistance, such as for homeowner rehabilitation assistance or economic development assistance. The paper that's used for the applications that interested persons fill out that want to apply for CDBG assistance. Also, what is eligible as an activity delivery cost are the travel costs incurred specifically for the carrying out of eligible CDBG-assisted activities. For example, the visits to the various sites where housing rehabilitation activities are being carried out to check the progress of the work being performed and also to conduct final inspections of completed rehabilitation projects. Also, depreciation and use allowances for vehicles used to conduct code enforcement and inspections only in CDBG-eligible areas. Note below that CDBG funds may only be used to pay for travel costs that are specifically related to a CDBG-assisted activity, and they cannot be used for travel costs in general.
There are more examples listed at the end of this presentation. They're kind of too numerous to mention in words, but you'll have that as a resource towards the end of the PowerPoint.
Thank you. What are program administration costs? Those are the costs for the staff time and overhead costs for planning and general administration of the CDBG program. As stated before, they cover the costs of planning, general management, oversight, coordination, monitoring, and implementation of the Community Development Block Grant Program as a whole. Eligible planning and administration costs may be found in our regulations at 24 CFR 57205 for planning and 57206 for general administration. A few examples of program administration costs that may be paid with CDBG funds. Leased office space for staff carrying out the CDBG program. The salaries of executive officers and staff with general program oversight responsibilities. These are usually your community development directors, your planners, and their administrative staff. The dissemination of education on fair housing is an eligible program administration cost. The cost of data gathering and studies on the needs for a specific activity, for example, a park and a CDBG eligible activity or a public facility, such as a recreation center, for example. The time that's spent developing general CDBG program policies and procedures, such as the application process for applying for CDBG assistance, and development of the procedures that will be used to monitor subrecipients for performance in accordance to the regulations. Now we're going to turn it over to Steve Johnson to speak about consolidated plan program administration costs.
Yeah, this is John. I'm just going to jump in here for a second and say, yeah, I mean, there's a long list of things that you can do, but the way that I think of this when we were writing the rules is that the program administrative costs are the most general, higher level kind of employees. So those people never get their hands dirty. And then you have at the activity delivery cost level, the people that are out there checking the, you know, the floor joists and you know, doing that for rehab or running social service programs, and they've got, you know, ketchup on their hands and charcoal and everything else. And then there's people and those people are pure activity delivery cost people. And then there's people in between, like the maybe their managers who do some general administrative stuff and sometimes get their hands dirty. And those people may have to split their costs.
Thank you. I think that's a good point. Gloria was just talking about some of the examples of program administrative costs, and some of them directly relate to the consolidated plan, the CAPR, some of the other costs. You can charge the entire cost of developing all the components of your consolidated plan to the CDBG program under the regulations. This is 570.205 and 570.206, as Gloria noted before. The reason you can charge the cost of the entire CON plan and your annual action plan to the program, despite the fact that you may have more than one program included in that, is because you have to do all of those same data evaluation, needs assessments, strategies, etc., regardless of which programs or how much money you get funded under. And because everybody who's doing a consolidated plan at least gets CDBG program. So that means the entire cost of developing your CON plan can be charged as a program administrative cost. The reason it's a program administrative cost is, as John said, you're not talking about individual activities here. You're talking about this overall plan that you develop in order to get your funding as a whole. So staff costs, indirect costs, costs of actually publishing the summaries of your plan, publishing your public hearing notices, the staff time of going to the public hearing and holding the hearing, etc., those are all fully charged to the CDBG program as a program administrative cost. If you hire a consultant to put together your consolidated plan or your action plan, those costs would also be chargeable as a program administrative cost. Likewise, the time you spend by you, subrecipients, nonprofit groups, consultants, whomever, that are developing your citizen participation plan, your annual CAPR, your analysis of impediments to fair housing, all of those are fully chargeable as a program administrative cost to the CDBG program because you are statutorily required to do those things regardless of whether you only get CDBG money or whether you get money from two, three, or all four of the formula programs. Now, before you get too carried away here, remember that just because the CDBG program allows you to charge the entire cost of those things, you still have to comply with other program requirements. If you're hiring a consultant to do your CON plan, you have to follow procurement requirements. If you're charging indirect costs, you have to have an indirect cost plan. You still have to comply with the 20% cap on planning and administrative costs. It's not just the cost of developing the CDBG portion of your consolidated plan that files under the 20% cap. It's the entire cost that you're charging to the program. Also, I think you need to keep in mind that you have larger expenses in this realm every couple years when you are doing your 3 to 5 year consolidated plan. You need to factor that in when you're thinking out over the next several year period, that the year in which you're actually doing your data analysis or you're actually writing your consolidated plan, or when you're updating your analysis of impediments, those additional costs, if you're going to charge them to the program, mean that you're going to have less time, less charges in other areas of program administrative costs that you're going to be able to charge the program. I made up the term calling that the cost bump, because it means you're going to have additional administrative costs every couple years.
Oh, I thought we were going to dance.
Oh yeah, this is that was the latest disco craze. That's right. It's
George Clinton calling.
Yeah, George Clinton. It was in fact it was originated at that famous government run discotheque Circular 54, I think.
Oh good.
Yeah, ha ha ha. You know, we are required to have at least one really lame joke in every presentation, and that was it.
Just Packer and ADC though.
In order to meet your affirmatively fair housing certification for the CDBG program and all your other programs that you're getting funding under, you also have to take actions that show what you're doing to overcome identified impediments to fair housing. You have to maintain records to that end. You have to report to us what you're doing. Those requirements are not unique to specific programs. Your fair housing certifications, the actions you take, those are things that you have to do as a unit of local government, and it applies to everything you're doing as a unit of local government, not just when you have your CDBG program hat on or your home program hat on. So those are not subject to requirements about specific programs. They are across the board. So therefore, any of those costs relating to fair housing are going to be chargeable as a program administrative cost if you wish to do that. Now, there is one little alternative when it comes to dealing with fair housing activities. To the extent that you are providing a service directly to citizens, like providing fair housing counseling, or you're holding public awareness campaigns on something, if you are directly benefiting individuals or groups of individuals, you can charge those as a public service activity under 570.201E. But keep in mind that if you are charging that as an activity, as a public service activity, then you are subject to the 15% cap on public services, which is actually lower than your cap on planning and administrative costs. Now, there is a difference here. I've just talked about costs that you are charging for your con plan, your CAPR, your analysis of impediments as a whole, the cost of actually doing those documents. It's a totally different story when you're talking about charging the costs of administering specific activities or specific programs that are covered in the consolidated plan. That's something totally different. Gloria is going to be talking about that in a few minutes. Closely related to this is when you can charge environmental review costs to the CDBG program, and are they program administrative costs or are they activity delivery costs? General environmental review work is eligible as a planning activity. It's not a program administrative cost. Remember, the statute defines and makes eligible separately program administrative costs versus planning costs. So general environmental work, design work, historic preservation work, general assessments, general remediation studies like a phase one environmental study are probably going to be planning costs. Activity-specific environmental review work, the cost necessary in essence to comply with doing a Part 58 review for a specific activity, specific assessments and clearance. Now those could be charged as a planning cost and they are subject to the 20% cap. However, because you are doing those for a specific activity, they are also eligible as an activity delivery cost of that specific activity. So there's really no advantage to calling them a planning cost, providing that the activity actually gets completed. And again, remember, we are going to talk about what about discontinued activities later on. Whether or not a cost is most appropriately charged as an activity delivery cost or as a planning cost may depend a little bit on just how detailed, how site-specific, how activity-specific that work is. If you have a vacant parcel out by the freeway interchange and you're trying to figure out what would be the highest and best economic use for that site, that sort of a study or that sort of planning is going to be a planning cost. On the other hand, if you've got three development proposals in from three different hotel developers and you're trying to figure out and underwrite whether the Hilton full-size Hilton Hotel versus the 100-unit Comfort Inn versus the Motel 6 with the Wendy's on the outlot, which of those is going to be the best deal for you and is the most financially sound, Well, that's probably going to be an activity delivery cost, but now you're talking about a specific activity that you want to undertake. Now, as Gloria is about to tell you, activity delivery costs have to meet a national objective. Planning costs, program administrative costs do not have to meet a national objective. It is just sort of a given that they meet program requirements. So if no specific activity comes out of those costs, there's no accomplishments, you are going to have to recategorize those potentially after the fact as a planning cost or an activity delivery cost. That's what we're going to be talking about under discontinued activities. And again, you need to think about that in advance when you are plotting out how you're going to be complying with the 20% cap on planning and administrative costs. John, I think it's time for another poll question now, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Thanks, Steve. Yep, here's our second poll question, another true and false, true or false question. And here's the statement, CDBG funds may be used to purchase office space for carrying out the CDBG program. If you could take a moment to give your best answer. I know the answer because it's right here in front of me. It was given to me. I'm cheating, but easy for me. So people are leaning towards true. The actual answer is false. CDBG funds may only be used to lease and not to purchase office space for carrying out the CDBG program. And you can look to 570.206 subsection A4 for details on that. Okay, thank you for responding. And with that, we're going to hand it back over to Gloria.
Okay, thank you, John, very much. We will now discuss charge and activity delivery costs for other consolidated plan formula programs to the CDBG program, which, as you know, the other formula programs are HOME, ESG, and HOPA. Activity delivery costs for HOME, ESG, or HOPA-assisted activities must be for activities that are CDBG eligible and meet a national objective. These activities may be only assisted with HOME, ESG, or HOPA funds, or assisted with both CDBG and HOME, ESG, or HOPA funds. Any activity assisted in whole or in part with CDBG funds are required to meet all CDBG program requirements and subject to all CDBG rules, in addition to the rules of the other grant programs.
This is an important principle here. I mean, this basically sort of drives almost all the rest of the slides, because so you don't have to remember if a specific activity is eligible. You just have to remember that it has to be CDBG eligible, it has to meet a national objective, and in some cases it can be allowed, as we'll hear in a minute, if it's specifically authorized by Congress. But everything else, if your activity doesn't meet a CDBG eligibility or national objective standard, then you can't do it.
Thank you, John. As John just alluded to, Congress did authorize CDBG funds to be used to pay activity delivery costs for housing services in support of home-assisted activities, such as housing counseling, work specifications, energy auditing, loan processing, and tenant selection. Now, there is no such authorization for ESG and HOPA. However, activities that are eligible under ESG and HOPA that are also eligible under CDBG are your public services such as mental health care, regular health care, homeless services, transportation of unsheltered persons, life skills training, emergency health services, acquisition, rehabilitation, lease of, and repair facilities to provide housing. All of these activities, as I stated before, except the building renovation and acquisition, are CDBG eligible public services. Keep in mind, for public services, for them to be eligible for CDBG assistance, they must be either a new service or a quantifiable increase in the level of an existing public service, which has been provided by or behalf of a unit of general local government during the preceding 12 months. And as you know, the CDBG public services cap is 15% of a grantee's annual CDBG grant plus 15% of the preceding year's program income. The acquisition of property by lease for CDBG program purposes has to be for a minimum of 15 years, it may be more, and repair properties for housing. These activities may qualify as either rehabilitation of public facilities if the intent is to only provide transitional housing. However, if the grantee's intent is to provide permanent housing, then the acquisition and repair properties would be considered housing rehabilitation rather than the rehabilitation of a public facility. Activities that are ineligible under the CDBG program may not be paid with CDBG funds. ESG and HUPWA-assisted activities such as payment of last month's rent, utility payments up for 2 years, short and medium-term rental assistance. I want to quantify that short-term in other programs usually means 6 months. These activities are not CDBG eligible, so CDBG funds may not be used to pay the activity delivery costs of these activities. Also, project or tenant-based rental assistance, new construction of single-room occupancy dwellings unless carried out by a qualified CBDO, short-term rent, mortgage, or utility payments that do not meet the criteria at 24 CFR 570-207B4, which is income payments. These are not CDBG eligible activities, therefore CDBG funds may not be used to pay activity delivery costs for these activities. Okay, we will now discuss charge and activity delivery costs for other CPD programs such as your homeless programs and other federal programs, the Homeless Management Information System, EZs and ECs. With regard to the homeless programs, it's a consolidation of supportive housing programs, Shelter Plus Care, and Section 8, Moderate Rehabilitation Single Room Occupancy. These have been consolidated. There are activities that are eligible under these programs that are also CDBG eligible, supportive services to assist homeless participants to independent living, outreach, child care, job training are examples. The operation costs of a supportive housing facility, such as the maintenance equipment, supplies, insurance, food, furnishings, etc., those are eligible as well. Also, the acquisition or lease of property to construct or rehabilitate supportive housing for homeless persons, which are generally your homeless shelters. Also eligible are public service activities such as alcohol and drug abuse treatment, health care treatment, mental health treatment, education services, and job placement. Activities that are eligible under the homeless programs that are not CDBG eligible are rental assistance that are connected with the moderate rehabilitation of single room occupancy units, and project and sponsored-based rental assistance. I did want to note here, you see the asterisk, the rehabilitation costs must be paid for with another funding source in accordance with the regulations for the homeless programs. And CDBG funds may be used to pay for that rehabilitation of those single-room occupancy units in common areas. This would be considered rehabilitation of a public facility in accordance with 24 CFR 570-201C, since these are transitional facilities. With regard to the Homeless Management Information System, Community Development Block Grant funds may only be used to support the HMIS system only in these instances. The cost must be activity delivery cost of a public service activity that's carried out in accordance with 24 CFR 570-201E. The grantee must be carrying out a CDBG-eligible public service that meets a national objective. Examples of eligible CDBG costs would include staff time for using HMIS for client case management, for services being provided to homeless persons or relating to the operation of a homeless shelter.
Yeah. One question that we got up raised on this earlier had to do about the cost that you spend using basically harvesting data out of your HMIS system for your needs assessments, for example, for doing your homeless and special populations needs assessment in your consolidated plan. And somebody said, well, shouldn't that be an eligible cost then, because doesn't that make the HMIS system eligible because you're using it as a data source for your CDBG program and your con plan? Well, the time actually spent probably running the reports and analyzing that data, sure, you could charge that time, say an hour or two, whatever it is, as a program administrative cost. But the reason the HMIS system exists is not to develop data for your consolidated plan. The reason it's there is to manage your homeless programs and specifically to manage and oversee the client base for programs that are not necessarily CDBG eligible activities.
Thank you, Steve. With regard to the other CPD programs of EZs, ECs, and RCs, for your information, the EZ and RC designations have expired. However, there are currently 30 EZs that remain. There are eligible EZ activities that are also CDBG eligible, provided they meet a national objective. Assistance to businesses, the establishment and expansion of microenterprises, and also tied to that are the services such as job training, child care, and job-related counseling is also eligible. Public improvements such as water and sewer and street widening, if they are impediments to one or more businesses that are located in the EZ. We will now discuss other federal programs. CDBG funds may be used to pay activity delivery costs for other federal programs, such as the Department of Agriculture's Child and Adult Care Food Program and Child Nutrition Programs, the School Lunch Program, the Department of Health and Human Services Head Start Program, and their Low Income Home Energy Assistance Program. However, keep in mind that if activity delivery costs are to be charged to the CDBG program, these activities must be in the Consolidated Plan, Action Plan, or Amended Plan, be an eligible CDBG activity, meet a national objective, and meet all other CDBG program requirements, such as Davis-Bacon, environmental review, et cetera.
And that's important because those other federal programs may have different requirements when it comes to environmental review or labor standards.
Right.
If you're putting CDBG money into it, you then have to follow the CDBG program, the HUD, you know, labor standards and procurement and environmental review requirements.
Right.
John?
So that, I was just going to point out that this is another restatement of the kind of the basic principle here. It has to be CDBG eligible, meet a national objective, and then comply with all other rules. And sometimes those can trip you up. You know, you're up against a 15% public services cap, or you can't afford to pay Davis Bacon, or whatever it might be. So so that's the little, if you want to memorize something, that'd be it.
Thank you, Steve, and thank you, Joe. The eligible activity delivery costs for these programs include public services, public facilities and improvement, housing rehabilitation, economic development, and assistance to micro enterprises. Some of the eligible costs include, they're not limited to, the salaries of drivers that conduct street outreach, to gather persons to take to homeless shelters, providing transportation services, healthcare workers, job trainers, mental health counselors, rental and space in buildings for the provision of public services such as the mental health care and regular health care, the materials that will be needed for job training such as computers, pens, papers, etc., and other items that may be needed to provide a job training skill.
And I think it's worth noting here that you may be doing a public service activity that is almost all activity delivered costs, because it's a staff intensive kind of program like these ones that are listed here. I mean, this is the service and these are the people doing it, compared to, let's say, doing housing rehab, where you have a housing inspector and then you have the rehab itself, the sort of those hard costs. You know, in the case of public services and maybe a couple other activities, you may be looking at all activity delivery costs. Not that it really matters, because it's part of the activity. So, but just in terms of understanding the distinction.
Thank you, John. We will now talk about charge and program administration costs for other consolidated formula programs to the CDBG program. As you know, CDBG funds may be used to pay program administration costs for the home program. This is authorized by the Housing and Community Development Act. The authority also covers overall management and administration costs for the implementation of home activities that are not eligible under the CDBG program, such as tenant-based rental assistance and new housing construction. With regard to ESG and HOPWA, the same statutory allowance is not there for these programs. Therefore, CDBG funds may not be used to pay the cost of the administration and management of ESG and HOPWA, nor the salary of a staff person in a general administrative position that works only on the administration of the ESG or administration of the HOPWA program. However, there are exceptions. CDBG funds may be used for staff administration costs that are associated with eligible ESG and HOPWA activities that are also CDBG eligible, such as homeless services, health screening, job training, health care. If these activities carried out are CDBG eligible, stated before, and they have to meet all CDBG program requirements. And those are the cross-cutting requirements we mentioned earlier. I want to point out, though, if a staff person spends most of their time administering the CDBG program and only a small part of his or her time carrying out general administrative functions for the ESG or HOPWA programs, CDBG funds may be used to pay his or her salary for the administrative staff time that's allocable to the CDBG program, and for administration of only CDBG eligible ESG and HOPWA activities. Quick example, if someone spends 80% of their time on at CDBG at program administration, 20% of their time on ESG and HOPWA, and let's say 10% of that 20 is spent on public service type activities such as health screening and job training, and the other 10% is for rental, tenant-based rental assistance or project-based rental assistance, then only 90% of their salary may be charged to the CDBG program.
And it's always worth remembering, as we're talking about this, you have to have time records to demonstrate that.
May take you longer to fill out than might get back for it.
John's making a good point. You may have to make the decision, is it really worth charge those costs?
Record keeping, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. We will now discuss charge and program administration costs for the other CPD programs mentioned earlier and other federal programs. with regard to the homeless programs. The Housing and Community Development Act prohibits CDBG funds for paying the cost of the administration and management of the shelter plus care and the supportive housing programs, and it does not permit the salary of a staff person in a general administrative position that works only on the administration of these programs to be paid with CDBG funds. CDBG funds may not be used to pay for program administration costs for activities that are eligible under the Shelter Plus Care, such as the rental assistance, but are ineligible under the CDBG program. An exception is that CDBG funds may be used for program administration costs that are associated with eligible, CDBG eligible, that is, supportive housing programs and Shelter Plus Care, such as your supportive services, which are your public services, only if these activities are otherwise CDBG eligible and meet a national objective and all other CDBG cross-cutting requirements. With regard to program administration costs for HMIS, CDBG funds may not be used to pay for the administration of the Homeless Management Information System because CDBG funds may not be used to pay the general administrative costs of the ESG program or any other homeless programs under the authority of 24 CFR 57206. That is because, as Steve said before, this system is primarily for the collection of data for the continuum of care programs and homeless programs. It's not a data source for CDBG-assisted activities that benefit homeless persons. With regard to your EZs, ECs, and RCs, the statute does allow for CDBG funds to be used to pay planning and administration costs for the overall administration of a federally designated EZ or EC. However, CDBG funds may not be used to pay planning and administration costs for RCs or renewal communities because they are not included as eligible communities under the statutory or regulatory provisions that govern the CDBG program. With regard to other federal programs, CDBG funds may not be used to pay the planning and administration costs for the overall administration of other federal programs, even the ones I mentioned before, even if some of the activities are CDBG eligible and meet a national objective.
We're talking about non-HUD programs here, right?
Yes, yes, such as Health and Human Services programs,
right,
that I mentioned before.
Yeah. And it's also worth pointing out here, you need to be mindful of the fact that the OMB Circular A87, Cost Reasonableness and Allowability, has the general proviso that costs that are chargeable to one federal program shall not be charged to another federal program. The way we get around that, when we're talking about activity delivery costs particularly here, is because those were eligible activities in the CDBG program, and thus by using your money on activity delivery costs, you are now making it a CDBG eligible activity, a CDBG assisted activity. But the general rule, and of course there's lots of exceptions, as Gloria has already pointed out to you, the general rule is no, you can't charge costs of other programs to CDBG or those other programs. You have to keep them separate. Yes, program administrative costs.
ADCs are okay if it's eligible and it's the national objective and we play by all the other rules.
Precisely. Well put, John. Okay, Gloria.
Thank you, gentlemen. We will now discuss activity delivery costs that are incurred for discontinued or terminated activities.
And these are, when we say that, we mean activities where you start an activity and then it never gets completed. You, for some reason, you know, it's going to cost too much, or you know, you run into some obstacle, and so you just say, oh, never mind, we're going to drop that activity.
So it's not about Arnold Schwarzenegger, then?
No, that doesn't have anything to do with the Terminator.
Grantees have two options with regard to activity delivery costs that are incurred for discontinued and terminated activities. One, they may charge these activity delivery costs as program administration costs only if the 20% planning and administrative cap will not be exceeded. That's crucial. Or they can elect to repay to their CDBG line of credit or program account the amount that was spent for the ADCs. Repayment to the line of credit or program account will depend on the year in which these funds were actually drawn down.
I just want to point out that NSP looks at that a little bit differently because we have a smaller list of eligible activities. So for those of you wearing both of those hats, this is a little bit different than the way the rule has been applied for NSP.
Yeah. And the reason, as John has pointed out in some of his comments throughout here, is you can only charge activity delivery costs where there's actually an activity. You have to have, it has to meet a national objective. Therefore, there have to be beneficiaries in order to meet a national objective. If the activity never gets completed, there's no beneficiaries. There's no accomplishment. Therefore, no national objective is met. Therefore, you can't charge activity delivery costs to it. That you would have to retroactively make them program administrative costs.
You haven't delivered.
You haven't delivered. Yes. Well put. I think it's time for another poll, isn't it, John?
I think it is. I think you're right. Yes, this is our third poll question and our last one in the webinar. So here's a scenario for you to consider. Consider a grantee X, which is amending its action plan to add an activity. Making the amendment, publishing it, and submitting it to HUD is considered which type of staff cost? Program administrative cost, activity delivery cost? And I see people voting. And it's overwhelmingly to program administrative costs. Steve, do you want to answer that one?
Sure. Give yourself a round of applause if you said it's a program administrative cost. The tricky thing when we wrote this question is people might think, oh, well, we're just adding one activity, so can it be an activity delivery cost of that activity? No. If you're charging costs relating to your con plan, it is a program administrative cost and nothing else. We're now going to sort of start circling back towards where we started from. We want to talk about compliance with the 20% cap on, when we say planning and administration, remember, planning is a separately eligible activity. When we say administrative costs here, we mean program administrative costs, not activity delivery costs. A question that I always like to ask, but we didn't put it in the poll, is where in the law, in our statute, do you find this 20% cap? It's a trick question because it has never been in the Housing and Community Development Act. Congress includes it in each year's appropriations bill. It's sometimes good to break this compliance with the 20% cap down into sort of a series of questions. First is, well, 20% of what for a year? Compliance with the 20% cap on planning and program administrative costs is computed for all of your expenditures and obligations during your program year. It's during that 12-month slice of time, say from July 1 through June 30th, if that's your program year. The 20% of what is 20% of your grant amount, your allocation, plus the program income that you received during that program year. And it is based on everything you and all of your subrecipients do. And it is not, at this point, tied to what year the money is. We're not concerned about whether it was your 2013 grant amount or your 2012 grant amount. It's what you did during your 2013 program year. What counts against the cap? It's all of your planning costs under 570.205. It is your program administrative costs under 570.206. Activity delivery costs are not counted against the 20% cap. And I know one person had already dropped us a question saying, is there a percentage limit on activity delivery costs? No, there is no explicit limit on how much, what percentage of activity delivery costs you can charge to an activity. But it has to be reasonable. So, How do you actually compute the cap? Right, you take the sum of the expenditures this year. You subtract out unliquidated obligations as of the very end of your last program year. So if your program year is July 1 through June 30th, any unliquidated obligations that you had as of June 30th of last year, you subtract out. Then you add in all of the unliquidated obligations that you had at the end of this program year. Now, what is an unliquidated obligation to begin with? I'm not an accountant. I don't play one on TV. I try to put this in sort of a plain English term. It's an unliquidated obligation is an expense where you have incurred it. You have legally obligated yourself to pay for this, but you have not actually paid it out. Why does this even matter? Well, because under our regulations, compliance with the 20% cap is based on obligations during your program year. The regs actually say you shall not obligate more than an amount equal to 20% of your grant plus your program income. However, IDIS does not have you enter obligations into it. We get out of IDIS and out of your report expenditures and more accurately, drawdowns, disbursements. So you have to basically convert expenditures to obligations through manual adjustments in your CAPR to arrive at what you actually obligated. That's why you have to subtract out obligations from the end of last year and add in anything that was obligated but not expended this year. For example, let's say you choose to hire a consultant to update your analysis of impediments, which, by the way, would be, you know, updating your AI would be a very good thing to do if you haven't done it in a few years. And let's say your program year is July 1 through June 30th. So on June 30th, 2013, you finally got City Council approval, and so you signed the contract with the consultant to update your AI. You didn't actually pay anything out to that consultant until, you know, July, August, September of 2013, which is this program year, but you obligated that amount last program year. Then let's say we get to the end of your current program year and you decide you're going to hire a consultant to do some planning study for you. Again, you didn't obligate that money until really close to the end of this program year and you didn't actually pay anything out. So you would subtract out the unliquidated obligations from your AI consultant as the end of last year, and you would add in the unliquidated obligations for your planning consultant at the end of this year. Now, what happens if you don't comply with the cap? This is not a pleasant topic to talk about. Nobody likes to admit that sometimes they didn't get it right. The cap is a 20% cap on planning and administrative costs is a statutory requirement. HUD cannot waive it. We can't make it go away. It is a statutory requirement. As I said, Congress has shown a lot more interest in the question of administrative costs in the last couple years than they did before. They're particularly wondering about how many grantees are actually complying with the cap. In past years, field offices could get away with rectifying a non-compliance situation by telling the grantee, all right, you over-obligated this year by $50,000, so to correct that, you will have to under-obligate by $50,000 next year to make up for that. As a result of a bunch of things, the congressional interest in this topic, the Office of Inspector General audit that we went through a couple years ago, realizing what we're dealing with here, we took sort of a second look at that. We reconsidered that here in headquarters. We talked to our attorneys, and we frankly decided we had been doing something that probably wasn't really allowable. There really is no statutory or regulatory basis to let somebody sort of under-obligate in a future year to make up for an over-obligation in the past year. So, Last May, our Deputy Assistant Secretary Yolanda Chavez issued a memo to all grantees and field offices that says, henceforth, if you exceed your public service cap, or if you exceed your planning and administrative cost cap, the only acceptable corrective action is to reverse your program for that amount. We cannot allow that anymore. And you cannot deal with some sort of averaging process here. If you go over in 1 year, you can't under-obligate or under-expend in the next year to make up for it. This is not like carrying an investment loss forward on some IRS tax form. Likewise, if you intentionally under-obligate, your policy is you're never going to go more than 18%. It's not like you get to bank that other 2% for some future year. You've got to meet the requirement for that 20% cap each year at its own time. And remember again that 3 to 5 year con plan cost bump that you got to factor in here. If you go over the cap because of your cost for developing your consolidated plan, I'm sorry, you're going to have to pay that back. Lastly, sort of bringing it all back home, urban counties, which is what, as I said at the beginning, sort of started this notice down the path to where it eventually came out. Urban counties, those of you who are an urban county or work with one, as you know, urban counties as grantees wear multiple hats. They are the grantee from HUD. They have a contract with HUD. A county may carry out activities directly. They may give some or all of the money to the units of local government that make up the county. The units of local government carry out those activities. And then the county performs the general management and oversight like a subrecipient. Now, when an urban county carries out an activity directly, there's really nothing different from anything else we've talked about here. The county has to make a distinction between its general program administrative costs and its activity delivery costs. But what do you do when the urban county is perhaps carrying out some activities itself and giving money to the units of local government? And then the units of local government carry out some activities, all right? Now there are going to be activity delivery costs that have to be rolled up into this program. Some of them are from the county itself, some of them are from the local governments. So the county has to make sure that they're matching those correctly and keeping track of those. And then there will be the program administrative costs of the county. If the county is carrying out some activities, they will have some general program administrative costs associated with those. And then when they are overseeing their units of local government, making sure that the local governments are following all the rules and getting the activities done, that's general management and oversight. That is a program administrative cost. And that's kind of where this issue came from to begin with. Because in the case of the specific county that sort of started all of this, the county said there are certain things that we ourselves are going to do. The local governments get all the money and they carry out, you know, the housing rehab, the sewer line replacement, those sorts of things themselves. But the county staff said, no, we're going to handle all the labor standards requirements. We're going to handle all the environmental reviews. We're going to handle the Uniform Act, acquisition and relocation requirements. We think that's too much of a burden to put on the local governments.
For specific projects.
For specific activities. So when the local government holds their bid opening, the county staff would come and do the presentation on, you know, wage rate interviews and, you know, labor standards reporting. So now in that case, the county actually does have some activity delivery costs that they could charge to that activity, to the extent that they are doing the environmental review, to the extent they're going out and doing the wage rate interviews and reviewing the weekly payrolls. Those would be activity delivery costs for that activity, even though the town is carrying out the rest of the activity, the construction. But a county has to make sure that they are differentiating, you know, which hat they're wearing at any given moment. If they're actually going and doing wage rate interviews, fine, now they've got their activity delivery cost hat on. But if they are simply going to the local bid opening, sort of to fly the flag of, we're the county, this is our money, we're here to make sure the town is doing things right, well, that's a general program administrative cost because they are simply overseeing their subrecipient. They need to keep those costs differentiated. They need to have time records. It can be trickier. All right. We're not going to go through these, but as John mentioned before, we've got on our slides here a number of examples of other activity delivery costs for ESG, home, etc., ineligible costs. We do not have time to go through these, but these slides will be available to you on the HUD Resource Exchange. And still getting here down to the last. Here we go. All right. John.
Okay. Thanks, Steve. Yes, as Steve just said, we're going to open it up to the webinar to questions. And again, due to the large size of this audience, we're only going to respond to written questions. We're only able to. So please use the Q&A pod on the left of your screen to submit those questions. We have a handful there already, but this is your chance to address any specific questions you have, so please enter them. And, yeah, back to Steve and Gloria and John Laswick to address your questions.
All right. Thank you. We've got about 15 minutes left, and as John had noted before, we probably won't get to every one of the questions that you are asking. We are getting some excellent questions from what we can see here. One comes from somebody who has also gotten some disaster funding through their state, through the CDBG Disaster Recovery Grant. And the question is, are all the points being raised here consistent between the entitlement and the state-run disaster programs? Well, not necessarily. If you are an entitlement grantee, but you are getting disaster money from, say, the state of New York or the state of New Jersey, generally those disaster grants that are going to a state, the default position is they follow the state CDBG program requirements. However, each appropriation of disaster funding is a separate appropriations bill and often carries slightly different variations on requirements. So not every disaster funding stream has exactly the same requirements. And HUD may have granted waivers to a state for certain things. HUD has a lot more latitude and flexibility in granting waivers for disasters money than it does for the regular. So the odds are the default position would be is that it's going to follow the state CDBG program disaster rules, I'm sorry, for disaster funding. But check with your state because there may be specific alternative requirements that apply to that specific set of money. Another question here, Gloria, maybe you want to handle this one. Are refreshments for community meetings allowable as administrative costs or planning costs?
Yes. Actually, 2 CFR Part 225, also known as OMB Circular 87, does allow for these costs, but in calculating them here, they would be eligible under 57206B, which is public information, to disseminate information on the Community Development Block Grant Program, when you talk about community meetings. If you're going to dispense public information or meeting, it's eligible. However, for the affirmatively furthering fair housing, that would be 57206C, as in CAT, fair housing activity. As you know, activities under 57206 are program administration costs. So yes, the refreshments are allowed, as stated in 2 CFR Part 225. However, these costs must be reasonable.
And not all federal agencies have the same attitude about that, based on my experience. So.
Is the time spent enforcing Davis-Bacon requirements, interviews, payrolls, etc., considered an activity delivery cost since they're project-specific? Yes. Generally, the time you're spent enforcing the requirements or applying the requirements for a specific activity, that would be an activity delivery cost because you're charging it for that specific, you know, street reconstruction project. However, it could be that depending on how high up the person is that's doing this, there could be some program administrative costs. Let's say you let your subrecipient units of local government or your subrecipients handle the Davis-Bacon requirements themselves. If all you're doing is providing general training and oversight to them, that's going to be a program administrative cost because you're not actually doing the compliance, the enforcement yourself.
Your hands aren't dirty enough.
Yes. Can a jurisdiction charge CDBG for home administration for activities that are administered in other CDBG entitlement cities? In this case, this would be where your entitlement city is part of a home consortium. This is a really great question, and you're probably going to be surprised at the answer. The answer is no. Even though we said, yes, the CDBG program can pay for activity delivery costs and program administrative costs of the home program. Here's the trick here. The CDBG program also requires that your funds are used to benefit your grantees. We have a provision in our regulations that talks about activities outside your jurisdiction. If you are basically paying for administration of activities in another member of the consortium, those are not necessarily benefiting your residents. So unless you can meet the requirements of our provisions at 570.307 about activity delivery costs for activities outside your jurisdiction where your beneficiaries, your residents are benefiting, the default answer would probably be no. Gloria, you've got another question here.
Due to reduced HUD home and CDBG, we have applied for state funds that leverage home and CDBG. Can home and CDBG program administration costs and activity delivery costs be used to help fund activities? I have to admit I'm a little befuddled by this question because if you're an entitlement grantee, you cannot apply for funds from the state.
But for the home program, you can.
Okay, well, I can only speak to CDBG.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So I think if the question is, could you use CDBG money, your entitlement CDBG money, to help cover the cost of a home grant that you got from your state? Yes. Providing those are eligible activities and you're meeting our requirements. Now, you may want to coordinate with your state because, again, states have different set of requirements and a different way of viewing administrative costs. So you want to make sure that you're not setting yourself up to accidentally be in conflict with what your state home agency is looking for from you.
I'm learning all kinds of things.
Yeah. Now, that's a good question, too, because it's sort of a tricky question that you might not expect.
Which means it's probably going to be on the basically CDBG
test. Yes. Yeah. What John's not telling you is you will take all the really hardest questions here, and the next time we do a basically CDBG training or subrecipient monitoring training, we'll throw these questions back at you.
They look so simple on the surface.
Yeah. How should grantees report activity delivery costs in IDIS? This is actually a pretty common question. Activity delivery costs can be reported either as a separate activity or you can report it as part of the activity itself. So two ways you can do that. Let's say you've got $10,000 worth of activity delivery costs for a sewer replacement project. That's, you know, $90,000. Obviously, those are not realistic numbers in today's market. You could either set up one activity in IDIS for $100,000 for the sewer reconstruction activity, or you could set up an activity of $90,000 for the sewer reconstruction hard costs, if you will, and then a separate activity under the same matrix code as sewer reconstruction activity delivery costs. What you want to do depends on the level of record keeping you want to maintain. We do not require separate costs and activities set up for activity delivery costs. If you want to keep track of them separately by setting them up each as a separate activity, you can do so. Keep in mind, though, what you cannot do is set up one separate activity in IDIS that covers, say, all of your public facilities, because those may be eligible under different activities. You can't sort of roll all of your public facilities activity delivery costs together into one, or all of your public services together into one. You're going to have to, if you're going to break them out, you'd have to break them out for all of them. How do grantees document time spent on particular activities as opposed to the time spent on program administrative costs? It all comes down to record keeping. You're going to have to clearly document the time spent and the related charges devoted to implementing individual specific activities, and you're going to have to keep separate time records on your overall program administrative costs. Now, sometimes there are costs that are totally separate. They may not ever connect. But when you've got a smaller staff that's, you know, staff are wearing many hats, the same person that's doing your bid openings on your sewer project is also has their hands in underwriting housing rehabilitation loans, and they're also writing the con plan. Well, now they've got activity delivery costs for two different kinds of activities, plus they've got program administrative costs. So you're going to have timesheets showing how that person's time is being spent out. If it's a matter of somebody who does only one thing, the executive director or the community development director, all they do is overall management and budgeting, well, it's a little simpler because all of their time is likely to be a program administrative cost.
But you can default to program administrative costs on a split, on a person that's split. You can pay all, if you don't feel like keeping time cards for 27 different things that they do, they can all get paid by program administration subject to the 20% rather than splitting it all out.
Yes.
I mean, this is one of these cost-benefit things. You know, there's a lot of smaller grantees out there who, you know, one person does nine different things, and it may not be cost-effective to track that individually.
Mm-hmm. Gloria just got another question here. I don't know if she's ready. She's still.
I got an interesting one
John.
Here. Someone has pointing out that if we have to spend 75 minutes explaining this, maybe it's too complicated. And I would say it's not that complicated because, as we kind of keep coming back to that basic principle, you can pay activity delivery costs and most program administrative costs for another program, another project, or another program if it's CDBG eligible, if it meets a national objective, and it meets all the other rules. That's not that complicated. We try to give you a lot of examples here today, and I'm sorry if they made it seem complicated, but I think at heart it's really not that complicated, and we're going to continue to, you know, we have the memo, the policy notice out there, and we'll get some frequently asked questions out to hopefully simplify it even further.
We're getting down near the end of our time. We probably only have about 2 minutes left. Gloria, here's two other questions. How detailed must time records be? This kind of relates to the question I answered a minute or so ago.
Okay. With regard to persons that are administering the CDBG program as a whole, we're talking about program administration costs, the time sheets must show the amount of time that is spent daily administering the CDBG program and also time spent on the administration of other programs, so that the appropriate amount of CDBG funds may be charged for that person's salary.
Now, on the other hand, if somebody is expending 100% of their time just on one activity, for example, a housing rehab inspector or a code enforcement person, all they do is that one activity 8 hours a day, then all they have to do is provide a certification that they have spent all of their time on that activity. You do not necessarily have to keep time records when somebody's spending all of their time on only one thing.
Okay. thing.
What was the other question there, Gloria?
Someone, slide 7 states that activity delivery costs cover the cost of staff directly carrying out the activity. Does the cost of staff include training costs? And the answer to that is the training costs are only permitted if they are directly related to the activity being carried out versus general training for this staff person.
Yeah, an example here might be, we'll use somebody who's working on, say, multifamily housing rehabilitation program, loan program. If you want to send that person to training on, and the training is specifically on underwriting multifamily rental housing projects, and so you're doing that to train them specifically on doing that job, that could be an activity delivery cost. On the other hand, if you, as part of, say, your city union contract, have something that says a grantee is entitled to attend 1 week of training a year, and they want to go spend it on some sort of advanced IT training, or you require staff to take, you know, an hour of training every 6 months on IT security the way HUD employees have to do it, well, that's a general program administrative cost at best. Some of those things might not even be related to the CDBG program at all. Okay. I think we'll, let's see, John, let us know when we're about out of time. It looks like we've got about 1 more minute left that we can devote to questions. Are loan servicing costs eligible activity delivery costs? Generally, yes. However, we also have sort of an interesting situation that in that the answer is yes, if this is a program that is being carried out as a revolving loan fund, where you make loans, the loan repayments come back in to pay for more of those same kinds of loans. Our general counsel's office has said in general, once you've carried out the activity, you've made the loan to the business has done its thing, created its job, collecting program income is no longer a part of that specific activity because you're not necessarily using that program income for that exact same activity. So if you've got sort of a one-shot activity and you're not doing any more of those, the cost of actually servicing that loan might end up being a program administrative cost. But most grantees, when they have loan programs, they have set it up as a revolving loan fund to begin with because the intent is for it to be somewhat self-sufficient. So in those cases, the answer would clearly be yes, because you're using the loan servicing as a way to generate the program income to carry out the next round of loans that you're going to make.
Housing rehab, small business.
Sure. Could even be home ownership assistance activities, or in some cases somebody might set up a social service that's like, you know, tuition loans or down payment assistance or something. All right. I think we're out of time here. John, take it away.
All right. Thank you, Steve. Yeah, we're right at 90 minutes. So thanks to Steve and Gloria for presenting, and to our resource advisors from HUD, Diane, Puping, John, and Karen, for today's presentation, and thank you everyone for joining us today for this webinar. Please note, and if you could advance the slide on the screen, thank you, that CPD Notice 13-07 can be found on the One CPD Resource Library using the address shown on the screen. And a number of questions did come in at the end that we didn't have time to address, but a frequently asked questions document will be created, as we've mentioned before, to address those unanswered questions generated in today's presentation. The webinar recording and the PowerPoint presentation will be posted shortly on the One CPD Resource Exchange Training and Events page, also shown on the screen now. And as a reminder, an email will be sent to all attendees following the training with instructions for how you can get credit for this training and to complete the feedback survey. And that does it for today. Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your day.